Thank you for your patience. We're having a little bit of a technical difficulty. Continue doing what you're doing. We'll get started in just a second. Hopefully. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for your patience. Welcome to church. Hope you're having a wonderful day. I invite you to stand as we sing and welcome in this worship service. We're going to sing the song, House of the Lord.
We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. Of the Lord today. and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, 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 oh.
We were the beggars.
We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Let's sing that again.
We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, 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 oh.
You may be seated.
Well, good morning. Oh, you can do better than that. Come on, good morning. Oh, much better. Okay. Good morning, this beautiful spring day. Is my nose growing? Wait a minute. No. It's kind of nasty out there, obviously, but it is late March, and it's Indiana, right? So those of us who lived here for a while come to expect this. We had really nice weather recently. We thought, this isn't going to last, and sure enough, it didn't last. So, but you might be wondering, how can we sing there's joy in the house of the Lord today when it's so nasty outside, or the week that I've had, or even the morning I've had? You might even think, what about worldly events? Can there be joy in the house of the Lord going on in Ukraine? Well, that's a deep question, isn't it? But we are here today to have joy because of what God has done for us in Christ. So we think of what Jesus said, you will have trouble in this world, but take heart, I have overcome the world. So we can take heart that Christ has overcome the world, and that's why we can have joy in the Lord this morning. So let's pray and ask the Lord to join us. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have overcome the world through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who has died on the cross for our sins and rose from the grave and have justified us, standing righteous in your sight. So thank you. There's forgiveness, there's life, and we can take heart because of what you have done. Thank you for gathering us in person or online. Thank you for Living Branch Church. Thank you that we can have fellowship here and worship you in spirit and in truth. So bless the service now. Be with our pastor, Cody, as he preaches to us. Be with Glenn as he leads us in worship. Just bless the time we have together. May we be encouraged and equipped to shine your light in this world. All these things we ask in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Bruce, for that welcome. I invite you to stand if you're able and turn your attention in the bulletin to our call to worship this morning. Is the microphone not working? Might not be. This one is. From Psalm 16, I'm going to read the Lita portion and then you can respond with the people portion. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Praise the Lord.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to His temple draw near. Praise Him in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord who o'er all things so wondrously reigneth, shelters the under His wings, yea, so gently sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how thy desires e'er have been granted in what He doth prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely His goodness and mercy are here daily attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do, if with His love He befriend. To the Lord, oh, let all that is in me adore Him. All that hath life and breath, come now with praises before Him. Let the Amen sound from His people again.
If you're new or visiting this morning, we're so glad that you've joined us for worship. Each and every week inside our bulletin, we will put a question from the New City Catechism, and this is meant to be a memory device. This is a way for young children to learn the fundamentals of the faith, but not just children, it helps us adults as well. And so this week, we've got question 13, and the book of James tells us if you've failed at even one part of the law, you are guilty of all of it. And so it's not just that we can't keep the law perfectly, we can't keep the law at all. And so it is good news that we've got a God who takes care of the law for us. I'm going to read the question and then you can respond with the answer. Can anyone keep the law of God perfectly? Since the fall, no mere human has been able to keep the law of God perfectly, but consistently breaks it in thought, word, and deed.
Of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the your servant David, rebuilding a temple of grace. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wine in the world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Who was and who is and who is to come? Who was and who is and who is to come? Who was and who is and who is to come? Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's a year of Jubilee. Down of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's a year of Jubilee. Down of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
You singing this morning? It's very encouraging. I don't know if you noticed, it has been a wacky morning up here. All sorts of things, like we were getting it so like the guitar was playing, but the preacher couldn't preach, and there was no sound, but it would come out of here. And my son figured out that one, by the way, well done. But we had just all these kind of things going on, so I really appreciate you rolling with it. But it is, it's easy to get lost in that stuff. And just singing the song with you and lifting up and, you know, let the amen raise from his people again. You know, it's just wonderful to sing with you, and I've just been very encouraged by that this morning. This next song is a new one for us. It's not a new one for me. I've had it for a long time. I wrote this, I think, in like 2003, 2004, and it sat on a shelf for a long time. And I saw what some of what Cody was going to be preaching on, and I wrote this after a pastor was doing a series with us about how the Old Testament really shows us what the New Testament is doing. And when Moses strikes the rock, this is the symbol of what Christ is and the life-giving water from Christ. And so that's where this song comes from. It's the echo of the Old Testament helping us understand what's going on in the New Testament and God's plan. But to do this, this song has a male and female response section. So if you see in little parentheses, in certain sections, that's where the women are going to sing, and then the men will be singing before that. And to do that, I'm going to need to invite my lovely wife to come up and help me, as she's like, oh, you pulled me in. And so she will lead those parts. Lord, are you there?
river of life, the wellspring of hope rising up in all those who drink the cup of salvation will thirst no more. The water that flows from the rock will bring life again. That flows from the rock will bring life again. Come take a drink from the rock and receive life again. There are fountains we drink from daily, but still we are dry. Though we draw, our cups are empty, only you satisfy. The river of life
is flowing freely,
the wellspring of hope
is rising up,
and all those who drink
the cup of salvation
will thirst no more. Flows from the rock will bring life again. The water that flows from the rock will bring life again. Come take a drink from the rock and receive life again. Those who drink from the rock
will thirst no more.
And all those who trust in the rock
shall fear no more.
All those who stand on the rock
shall stand secure.
And all those who drink from the rock
will thirst no more.
And all those who trust in the rock.
I think it's on. Yeah, we're good. Allow me to share with you from James chapter 4. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and the earth bore its fruit. Would you pray with me? Father, we come to you this morning, just like Elijah, in our nature, fallen, not equipped to talk to you, not worthy of coming into your presence. And yet you desire us so much to talk with you, to share our burdens, and to come into your presence, that you gave us a way. You provided the way in your Son for us to enter into your presence as a righteous person. Lord, thank you. We praise you for that. We praise you for who you are in allowing us to come close to you. And for you hearing our prayers just as you heard Elijah praying and you withheld the rain from the earth. And then when you heard him again, you allowed it to rain and for the fruit to be borne by the earth. Lord, we have many people among us who are hurting. We have many people among us who are cheerful and sing praise. And we have many who are concerned with the state of where we are in our world and in our community and in our homes and in our church. So, Lord, we bring them this morning to you, those concerns and those praises, because you are worthy to receive our praises and you are worthy to hear our concerns, and you do answer. Sometimes not like we want to hear, but you do answer. So we praise you this morning. We thank you that we can gather together, and we know that there are many in our midst that are not here this morning because of spring break or travels or illness or any number of different reasons. And yet we are still a body of believers, still a church that calls upon your name. So Lord, hear our prayer. Be with those who cannot be in our presence, but be with them so that they might know you and know how wonderful and good you are. Be with our pastor this morning as he brings the message. Lord, might his words be clear and might ears be opened beyond what they've ever heard before. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for your church. Thank you for your son, Jesus Christ. Thank you that we might come to you and that you might hear us. We pray all these things in the great name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who died for us. Amen and amen. At this time in our service, we have an optional ministry for K through 2. And Mrs. Seelan, well, she is not singing this morning with her husband. She will be taking you back to the classroom. So you are dismissed. And Pastor Cody, come lead us. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob, for that prayer. And we have a tradition around here when elders retire, we still put them to work. So it's kind of a tradition. And so beware if you run for the office of elder. You know, there's no real retirement for you. So let's pray, shall we? God of our fathers, we ask that the breadth, the length, the height, and the depth of your word would become really sweet to us this morning. So we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, good morning again. Good to see you. If you don't know me, my name's Cody Brobst. I'm the assistant pastor here. And long before I went to seminary, I was a passionate young college student at Ball State. And about midway through, I had a big crush on a girl named Courtney. And this was a second crush because the first one was in high school and she crushed me at that point. But I waited another 8 years and was patient. And I finally convinced her to go on a date. And she was at IU, I was at Ball State. And one weekend, I decided to go down and visit her, and she took me to church. Now, This was a great worship service, but I had a problem because as I was listening to the pastor preach a sermon, he was preaching from the Psalms, and as a crew student, I was finally tuned to looking for certain things in a sermon. And I was waiting for the great climax where he would bring up Jesus dying on the cross and rising from the dead. And that moment never came. And so I'm sitting in my seat, gathering all the energy and all the mental frustration I can together to go put this pastor in his place as soon as the worship service was over. And I gathered a lot of courage. I don't know that my new girlfriend was too impressed by my boldness, but I walked up to this preacher after the sermon was over, and come to find out, this was Dr. Dennis McGarry, professor of Old Testament and Semitic languages at Trinity Evangelical Divinity School in Chicago, and two of his close friends in his hallway where he worked. To the left, you had D.A. Carson, the founder of the Gospel Coalition, and probably one of the most renowned New Testament professors in the world. And on the right, you had Dr. Bob Yarbrough, who later would take a role at Covenant Seminary, and he was somebody that I took classes with. I was his teaching assistant, and he's become a dear mentor of mine. He actually preached over here at my ordination service a few years ago. And so what did I learn other than maybe don't go up to an Old Testament professor and suggest that you might know the Bible better than he does, as somebody who at the time was still learning the Ten Commandments? Well, you can find Christ throughout the Old Testament. Absolutely, all things point forward in the Old Testament to Christ dying and rising again. Everything is about Jesus, his person, his work, and all of that. However, to get there, we don't need to force and cram Christ in every nook and cranny of every passage that we read in the Old Testament. You, of course, heard a great sermon last week. Pastor Dave preached for us on the first half of Acts 13, and this week we're going to look at the second half. And you might have remembered Pastor Dave had mentioned that we should make a beeline for the cross, right? So we want to read our Old Testament passages with an eye forward to the time of Christ dying and rising again. But as we do that, there's a few possible dangers for us that we want to be sensitive to as well. Now, I've got in front of me here two books. You might notice one is much thicker than the other. What do you think the one on the left is? That's the Old Testament. And the one on the right is the New Testament. I mean, that's pretty thin, right? And that's pretty thick. The Old Testament makes up 77% of our Bibles. It's a significant percentage. And, of course, this is all before the time of Christ. So as we read our Old Testament, there's two possible dangers. One danger is that all Old Testament passages merely exist to get us to the cross. That's the only point of those Old Testament passages. The second danger is that we might ignore the urgency of the commands in the Old Testament, because if you're like me, talking about Jesus is a little more pleasant. It's a little bit of a nicer crescendo, right? So if we skip to that, then we don't have to think about some of the laws that God brings to us in the Old. Now, if we think about these Old Testament passages, the cross actually accomplished for us all of those blood-bought graces that we find on every page of Scripture. And so when we turn to Acts 13, 26 to 52, you heard last week that Paul was preaching this sermon as a follow-up to a reading from the Law and the Prophets, right? And so looking in your bulletins, you'll see there's a reference there to 2 Corinthians 3:14. This indicates that the Old Testament can also be called the Old Covenant. And so, if you've been in Presbyterian circles for long, you will begin to hear certain words come up again and again, right? Westminster, Trinity, grace and peace. Well, another such word that you'll hear in these circles is covenant. Now, Keith and Susan and I, we all graduated from Covenant Seminary, and so it's one of those words you can get used to. You hear it so much, and you just forget about what special of a word it really is. Think about a marriage. Now, O. Palmer Robertson wrote a book called Christ of the Covenants, and he says, trying to define the word covenant is a little bit like trying to define a mother. I mean, it would be logically correct if I were to say that a mother is a human being who gives birth and brings a child into the world. For those of you who are moms, is that a sufficient definition for a mom? Do you merely exist to pump out a baby? See, covenant, we can define it. I can say to you that a covenant is a contract with two parties signed in blood with God as the initiator, promising life and blessing for covenant obedience and curses and death for covenant disobedience, but it wouldn't be enough. Because the entire Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, is promoting this exact same framework of operating. And so there are so many. Covenant is a diamond. It is multifaceted. And every time you read a new page of Scripture, there's another facet and another angle to covenant that's revealed. It's a beautiful thing. And so this morning, I want to consider the message of the word, the invitation of the word, and the application of the word from Paul's sermon here at Pisidian Antioch, starting in verse 26. Now, as a reminder, there was Antioch back in chapter 11, where the disciples were first called Christians. This is a different Antioch. So Pisidian Antioch is up in Asia Minor, and this is where they preach to an area where there would have been a mix of Jews and Gentiles. And so hear now the words of Luke. Brothers, sons of the family of Abraham, and those among you who fear God, to us has been sent the message of salvation. For those who live in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not recognize him nor understand the utterances of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath, fulfilled them by condemning him. And though they found in him no guilt worthy of death, they asked Pilate to have him executed. And when they had carried out all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead. And for many days he appeared to those who had come up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are now his witnesses to his people. And we bring you the good news that what God promised to the fathers, this he has promised or has fulfilled to us, their children, by raising Jesus. As also it is written in the second psalm, you are my son, today I have begotten you. And for the fact that he raised him from the dead, no more to return to corruption, he has spoken in this way. I will give you the holy and sure blessings of David. Therefore, he says also in another psalm, you will not let your Holy One see corruption. For David, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, fell asleep and was laid with his fathers and saw corruption. But he whom God raised up did not see corruption. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. You will notice that Paul addresses both the Jews and the Gentiles here. He says, sons of the family of Abraham and those who fear God, right? So he's fondly addressing them to lay out God's plan for Israel and the nations. Take a look with me at verse 26. He's saying this message of salvation is all one story. This is not a bunch of fragmented appetizers in a spiritual buffet that we can cherry pick. As Graham Goldsworthy put it, and I love this line, the pattern of the biblical storyline is about God's people being in God's place under God's rule and blessing. The pattern, the biblical storyline is about God's people being in God's place under God's rule and blessing. If you take that to every Old Testament passage, you'll see it again and again. It was actually the Bishop Melito in the second century who coined the term Old Testament. So you might wonder, where did we get the idea of Old Testament? Well, this was a second century bishop, and what a great name, Bishop Melito of Sardis in the second century. And what he was trying to do at the time was draw a distinction between the Hebrew Bible that would have been already accepted in the churches and the new books that were circulating amongst the churches talking about Christ and his death and resurrection. And in drawing that distinction, he was not at all aiming to say, well, now we have these new books, so we don't need the old ones, right? The Old Testament conceals what the New Testament reveals. That's a helpful way to think about it if you like rhyming like I do and my kids do. So the new reveals what the old conceals. And if you look at verse 27, it's really funny. Paul is almost calling out these guys comically, saying, you've literally been here every Sabbath. Every single week you come and I read from the law and the prophets, or you've been read the law and the prophets by someone else, and you still don't see that it was all about the Messiah, that it was all pointing forward to him. How did you miss it, right? So again, in verses 28 to 33, he wants to pound it in multiple times by saying things like, as he promised, as he fulfilled, as it is written. And we see two quotes here from Psalm 2 and Psalm 16. What's the point? Well, God is not just going to fulfill his covenant with Abraham, which is to promise descendants that number the stars. He's also going to be faithful to his covenant made with King David. And so Psalm 2 is looking forward to the title that Jesus would receive, the Son of God, right? Could see that. This is the only place, by the way, in the New Testament where the quote in the Old Testament is directly mentioned. This says the second psalm. That's pretty cool. And in Psalm 16, we see that the Holy One will not see corruption. And so this is not just giving Jesus a future title, Son of God. It's looking forward to the time where this Holy One, whoever he is, will not see corruption, meaning that death will not overtake him. And at the time, although King David will see in the future a fulfillment of this, at the time when King David was looking forward to his death, he knew he was going into the ground 6 feet under. This would be the end of King David. He died, and then he stayed dead, right? But he's looking forward to a time where there would be a resurrection, where this Holy One would not see corruption, and as a result, by association with him, we ourselves won't see corruption. And so if you know Jesus and he rose from the dead, well, there's hope for you to rise from the dead too. There's kind of an interesting reality here in verse 36 where Paul goes out of his way to say David had served the purposes of God in his own generation, and then he fell asleep. Now, why would Paul go out of his way to make mention of this? Well, have you heard of the old Van Gogh syndrome? You know, the idea of someone's not appreciated in their own time. You have a great author or a great artist who puts out this great work and nobody really cares. C.S. Lewis was kind of an example of that. People sort of didn't really quite appreciate Lewis. And then, you know, now look how popular he is. Why is it that people aren't appreciated in their own time? I don't know. There's probably a lot of reasons for that. But it's interesting to me that there doesn't seem to be much of a concern here for people being appreciated in their own time. Rather, serving God's purposes faithfully in one's own generation is the point. And so, you know, today Twitter is full of branding strategies. You know, it's not just businesses that have brands now, it's individual people. We have a brand, and we have to get online, we have to build our brand, because we need to be marketable so that people like us and they think great things about us. Doesn't seem that the Bible's too concerned about our brand. Rather, the idea is actually we need to sacrifice our brand for God's purposes. And perhaps it is the sacrificing of that brand which is the beginning of faithfulness. And that's the message of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, fulfilling God's purposes. But take a look with me now at the invitation of the word in verses 38 to 43. Let it be known to you, therefore, brothers, that through this man's forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. And by him, everyone who believes is which you could not be freed by the law of Moses. Beware, therefore, lest what is said in the prophets should come about. Look, you scoffers, be astounded and perish, for I am doing a work in your days, a work that you will not believe, even if one tells it to you. And they went out. The people begged that these things might be told to them the next Sabbath. And after the meeting of the synagogue broke up, many Jews and devout converts of Judaism followed Paul and Barnabas, who, as they spoke with them, urged them to continue in the grace of God. And so we see, yes, the Bible is all one message and one plan of salvation, but also it is one invitation. And this invitation doesn't just apply to a particular group of people. This invitation is for you. Through belief, you can be freed of your sins, and you can have a life that is changed, and you can have a Savior. That's the message of the Bible. So if you're new to church, this is not just, we don't get together because we're looking for a mental exercise or some kind of fun theological get together. This is real life. This invitation directly applies to us. And so we see that God had a covenant with Abraham and David, but Paul goes on to tell us about two more covenants in the Old Testament with Moses and with Israel. And so take a look with me at verse 39. He reminds them of the Mosaic covenant at Mount Sinai, where the Ten Commandments were given, and the covenant with Israel and the prophets. And so there was a kind of slavery in the law. There was a kind of bondage that the Israelites dealt with by virtue of being under the law and being expected to follow it all. All right. I want to give you a challenge, Living Branch. Starting today, ending next Sunday, if you faithfully can demonstrate to me that you have followed all 613 laws in the Old Testament, I will buy you and your family a very nice steak dinner. You only have to do it for 1 week. Let me give you a few examples to prepare you. Leviticus 19:10. Hear this, young moms. You must leave any fallen grapes on the ground for the poor to come and eat. Leviticus 19:19. Don't wear clothes made of linen and wool, and don't plant more than one kind of seed, you gardeners. Exodus 22, 2-3. You can't kill a thief during the day. You got to do it at night. If you're going to kill a thief, it's got to be at night. My favorite, Deuteronomy 25, 11-12. If a man's wife grabs you, chop off her hand. And also, no eating bats or owls. You cannot eat an owl, and you cannot eat a bat. It's probably going to disappoint some of you. It's an exhausting way to live, isn't it? Kind of enslaving. But let's appreciate the principles behind these laws, which the Old Testament is meant to bring out. You'll often hear people divide up the law. They'll say there's civil laws, there's ceremonial laws, there's moral laws. So anything that's civil or ceremonial, we just throw out the window, right? But the law of God is a window into the heart of God. And so the law is actually bringing out every single crazy law that you read in the Old Testament is actually trying to explain a moral principle. And so even the civil and the ceremonial laws, while Christ fulfilled them, one sacrifice for all, Hebrews 10, the law was but a shadow of the things to come. Christ fulfills the entire law in your place. But don't miss that every law in the Old Testament is meant to tell you something new about who God is and about what he wants you to do, right? So, I love nursery rhymes. I don't know if you're a fan of nursery rhymes, but Alice, in Lewis Carroll's Through the Looking Glass, meets a character by the name of Humpty Dumpty. And we know Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall, and Alice came to try to convince Humpty Dumpty to get down because, well, he might get really hurt if he falls off that wall. And in a smug manner, Humpty Dumpty looks back at her and says, "Well, I know the king." And so Alice kind of rolls her eyes and says, "I'm out of here. I'm leaving this guy to his own mess," right? Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. And all the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again. Glenn just sang, and Leanne, an awesome song up here about Christ being the rock and the foundation that we should put our feet on. And if we're like Humpty Dumpty, sometimes we use the law to build a big wall for ourselves and sit atop it, look good to others, and say, "Well, I know the king." But if we're not careful, and we aren't in our sin, our fragile shells will shatter, and we will be broken beyond repair. Our feet need to be down on the foundation, which is Christ. So the law was always pointing us forward to a greater foundation. When people say the law is the foundation and Christ merely builds upon it, no, Christ is the foundation. And the law tells us what that foundation is like. And so the invitation here is to believe. It's to ask for God's help. And unlike Humpty Dumpty, we got to turn in our pride because we have very fragile shells. Let's consider not just the message of the word or the invitation of the word, but I want to look as well at the application of the word in verses 44 to 52. Let's take a look. "The next Sabbath, almost the whole city gathered to hear the word of the Lord. But when the Jews saw the crowds, they were filled with jealousy and began to contradict what was spoken by Paul, reviling him. And Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly, saying, 'It was necessary that the word of God be spoken first to you. Since you thrust it aside and judge yourselves unworthy of eternal life, behold, we are turning to the Gentiles. For so the Lord has commanded us, saying, I have made you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth.' And when the Gentiles heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord. And as many as were appointed to eternal life believed. And the word of the Lord was spreading throughout the whole region. But the Jews incited the devout women of high standing, and the leading men of the city stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and drove them out of their district. But they shook off the dust from their feet against them and went to Iconium. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit." Amen. So although the message of salvation is offered as an invitation to all people, only some will actually accept this message. It's important to think about the lessons here in verses 44 to 52 as not just the application of the word to our lives, but as application points for us as we go this morning. First, the preaching of the word will not just draw fans, it will actually draw opposition. That's what we see here. They were all excited to hear Paul the next Sunday. They said, "Man, this was good stuff. Can you come back again next week and do it all over again?" They show up, and they're like, whoa. "We didn't think those guys would be here with us. We just thought you were just going to be preaching to us." And this didn't come as a surprise to Paul and Barnabas. So they respond boldly with this line that I don't think is just important for Acts 13. I actually think this line is important for the entire New Testament. "Since you thrust the word of God aside and judge yourselves unworthy of eternal life, behold, we are turning to the Gentiles." Wow. Then we see in verse 47 that this is a fulfillment of the promise in Isaiah 49. And so in the previous passages, back in verse 41, there was a comfort and a challenge as Habakkuk's complaint is being quoted, reminding us that freedom has been offered in Christ, but you have to turn from your pride. But then here, as we look at Isaiah 49 being quoted, we're learning that, oh, wow, so yes, the offer to turn from sins and to trust in Christ is being offered to everyone, but we see here that only certain people are going to respond to this message. And so we have to be prepared for that and not surprised by that as the message is going out and others are being invited in. Second, take a look at verse 48 with me. This teaches us the theology of whose heart will change in order that we might be okay with those responses instead of being surprised by them. Take a look finally at verses 51 to 52. And so we see that this word of God will go out. There will be fans, but there will also be those who oppose it. We also see that those who are appointed to eternal life will believe. Those who are not will not believe. This should not surprise us. We should be prepared for it as we go out. And then we finally see in verses 51 to 52 that one of the fundamental characteristics of a disciple of Jesus, if you want to follow Jesus today, one of the key characteristics is that you maintain your joy. As one who is filled with the Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit is joy. And so nothing that the world might say to you, nothing that those who might oppose the word of God do to you should take away your joy. Now, I'm not always joyful. I had days this week where I was very not joyful, and I had days this week where I was very joyful. This is about a reminder for us to not let our circumstances affect us. What do Paul and Barnabas do when they're persecuted and rejected by the word of God? They shake the dust off from their feet. So I'm going to ask you guys to make like Taylor Swift and shake it off. And I'm not kidding. When the circumstances of life seem to choke you, when people say things that frustrate you and trigger you, when that boss at work makes that unreasonable demand, when that family member that you've been dealing with for however many years continues in their ways, don't let it steal your joy. That is a fundamental characteristic of a disciple, and it's actually one of the ways that the gospel spreads to the ends of the earth. People see how you respond to bad circumstances. If we let go of our brand and we let go of our pride, we can truly be less affected by others. And I really love how the Puritan Richard Sibbes puts it. He writes a book by the name of The Bruised Reed, and it's got some really good stuff in there. But he says this: whatever Christ is freed from, I am freed from. It can no more hurt me than it can hurt him who's in heaven. So if we're saved by grace through faith, it's the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. This means that you don't have to be affected by other people's opinions. You don't have to care. I'm not saying don't love people. I'm not saying don't serve people. I'm not saying don't aim to be represented well before people. Our elders, one of the qualifications is that they must be represented well by outsiders. But it's different than trying to be liked. It's different than trying to please people. It's different than trying to make everybody do what you say. As a substitute teacher and as a father of three young girls, this is a crazy thought, but people don't always listen to what I say and what I ask them to do. Except for those of you who are here and attend East Middle School, you guys are angels and love you guys. But it's those other people, right? Sometimes people just don't listen to us. And we can be almost unproportionately affected by it. And yet, what we're told here in Isaiah 55:11 should be really, really helpful. This is a verse that I think every Christian should memorize. There in your bulletin. So shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty. It shall accomplish that which I purpose and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. How freeing is that? So I want you to imagine a worship service here at Living Branch where every decision the elders make and the staff make is specifically catered toward how marketable it is to other people. So we want everything to look pretty. No sound problems allowed. The microphones have to work perfectly all the time. And like the business world, our goal is to look perfect. And if there's anything we do that takes away from our marketability, we have to stop doing it. Which means that I have to stop preaching this sermon right now. Because if it's true that what we are doing is to make ourselves as marketable as possible to the world, and things that sound harsh or offensive or are not likable have to be rid of, I got to stop talking about sin, and I have to stop talking about needing a Savior. Paul's sermon, if you think about him being in Asia Minor, might have thought about this himself, that if I stopped saying certain things, the people might actually like me a little more, and the church might actually expand to the ends of the earth like I'm hoping. I wouldn't run into so many problems along the way. As a matter of fact, there's a point in the book of Acts I was reading this morning just for fun. It says that Paul decided to sail past Ephesus, and the reason was he wanted to get back to Jerusalem to celebrate Pentecost. But Paul said specifically so that he wouldn't have to spend any time in Asia Minor. And I can almost imagine introverted Paul saying, if I go and stop in Ephesus in Asia Minor, I'm going to have to deal with a lot of problems there. So I'm just going to sail back to Jerusalem. That's way easier. I won't have to deal with that, right? Our church might grow a lot if we say and do all the things that the world wants us to do. But would our confidence still be in the Word of God? That's my concern. In 2018, you may know the name Andy Stanley. He's a pastor down in Atlanta. And his father, Charles Stanley, famous televangelist, preached for many, many years. Andy Stanley, in the year 2018, wrote a book called Irresistible. And the idea was not irresistible grace. That was not what he was going for. But Andy Stanley said this: the church has a big problem. Numbers are declining. People aren't attending churches. People don't seem to care anymore. And so we need to make a change that will change the narrative. We've gotten off the railroad tracks, and so in order to get back on the railroad tracks, here's what we're going to do. We're going to unhinge from the Old Testament completely. We're going to throw out all of those passages because the Old Testament is harsh. The Old Testament talks about an angry God. The Old Testament is so enslaving with all of those laws and all that rigorous law-keeping. But the New Testament is a totally different story. The New Testament is about love. It's about acceptance. It's open and it's freeing. And if we want the world to know Jesus and to love Christ, we got to get rid of that Old Testament completely. Now, this might be relatively shocking for some of you to hear, and yet, there's nothing surprising or new about it. As a matter of fact, in the second century, there was a man by the name of Marcion who proposed this exact same thing. He thought that the Old Testament was a tale of false gods, and that if we get rid of the Old Testament, we can focus just on the cross and the resurrection. We don't need the Old Testament. We only need this 23% of the Bible. Now, Stanley is to be commended for his heart for the lost, his desire to see new people come into the kingdom, and yet he's forgotten about the offense of the cross. He's forgotten that the message of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation is one story. It's not a spiritual buffet. You can't cherry pick. It's all or nothing. Michael Kruger astutely observed when he mentioned that for 2,000 years, the church has upheld the relevance of the Old Testament by suggesting that the early church had rejected this unanimously. Marcion was put out of the church. He was not befriended by the Christians. And Michael Kruger tells us this. While Andy Stanley is right that a person does not have to believe the Bible in order to be saved, the Bible itself has to be true if they're going to be saved. Jesus is the fulfillment of the whole Bible, and ultimately, at the end of the day, Jesus is the author of the Bible. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Not being ashamed of the gospel, as Paul says in Romans 1, is not just about us admitting that a guy died on a cross for our sins and rose from the dead. Paul's not ashamed of the entire good news from Genesis to Revelation, the God who was and is and is to come, and every single one of God's promises as laid out in his word. It means that we stand on the Bible wholesale and we don't just select the parts that sound good to us. Every single one of God's promises is worth us singing about, and every single one of God's promises is worth you hanging on to this day and each day. Let's pray. Father in heaven, the Word was, the Word is, and the Word will be. We thank you that you can do immeasurably more than all that we can ask or think. We thank you that this message is one story. We thank you that you extend this invitation to all, but not all will accept it. And as we do, Lord, we know that our joy is to be held on to. And we pray that you would help us to do that this Sabbath and each day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'd like to invite you now to turn your attention to the next part of our bulletin on the next page, which is a time for us to confess our sins together. And again, we don't do this in a self-deprecating way. I love to remind people that confessing your sins is one of the most dignifying things you can do as a human being, because there's good news on the other side. Let's read from a Reformed worship confession together. O Christ, my Savior, help me. I'm slow to learn, prone to forget, and weak to climb. I am in the foothills when I should be on the heights. I am pained by my graceless heart, my prayerless days, my poverty of love, my sloth in the heavenly race, my sullied conscience, my wasted hours, my unspent opportunities. I am blind while the light shines around me. Take the scales from my eyes, grind to dust my heart of unbelief. Make it my highest joy to study you, meditate on you, gaze on you, sit like Mary at your feet, lean like John on your breast, appeal like Peter to your love, count like Paul all things but dung. I believe, help my unbelief, in Jesus' holy name, amen. Friends, I invite you to stand as we receive the good news of the gospel and this assurance of pardon from Acts 13, 38 to 39, which you heard earlier. Let it be known to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, that through this man Jesus, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you, and by him everyone who believes is freed from everything from which you could not be freed from by the law of Moses. What joy there is in that, and this joy is worth us singing about now.
Thank you.
shakes with joys around the earth and then reflect thy rays. Stars and angels sing around the center of unbroken praise. Field and forest, vale and mountain, flowery meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in thee. Thou art giving and forgiving, ever blessing, ever blessed. Wellspring of the joy of living, ocean depth of happy rest. Thou our Father, Christ our brother, all who live in love are thine. Teach us how to love each other, lift us to the joy divine.
We're going to go back to that first verse, joyful, joyful.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day.
Wonderful. Thank you, Glenn and Leanne. Wonderful to hear your voices as well this morning. And as you can see, there's a few announcements in your bulletin. See Aubrey for Financial Peace University, going to be starting a fresh class on April 3rd. I've been in the class and I've heard him. It's a wonderful opportunity. There are people in our community who absolutely need this. And it's a great opportunity for us to rub shoulders with those in the community. Also make sure to congratulate David Lynn, who sustained his exams for ordination yesterday morning. We want to apologize for the error there in your bulletin. He's not been elected yet, but he has been nominated. And you can see there, May 1st, we'll have a meeting to hold that election for members. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.